Mr. Narasimhan, ex-Member of Parliament, my friend Mr. Manu Srivastava, and all the dignitaries, all the participants who are present in this conference. The purpose of this conference, as I've been told, is you're discussing about the government, various taxes, policies, then innovation, and something related to tracking, O&M, etc. In my address, I'd like to brief you about what the Government of India policies are now and what we are planning to come out in the times to come for achieving the goal of 100 gigawatt by March 2022. If you know that just 2 years back, the target itself was 20,000 megawatt to be achieved by March 2022, when the present government increased it fivefold, and the target was made to 1 lakh megawatt, 100 gigawatt. The impact is that by March 2018, we are going to cross the target of 20, and it is almost 22 gigawatt will already be achieved by this year end, by March. This is the impact of such a high target, and now the balance has to be achieved at the rate of 20 gigawatt per year. A very, very mammoth target, but very glad to inform you that industry is already geared up. They have accepted the challenge and they are ready to come out with all solutions how to achieve it. In order to give a confidence to the industry, first of all, first step, what our ministry has done is they have published on our website what is our trajectory, how we are going to achieve this. If there is a definitivity in the system, people know, industry knows this is how they are going to get a business, then they definitely gear up for that. So, we are already by March 18, by end of March 18, we will be, in addition to 22, additional 20,000 megawatt will be bid out. And 14 has already been done. We are coming up with additional 6,000 megawatt bids in this month, and 30,000 in next year, and 30,000 in 2019-20. By March 2020, we will have invited all the bids for 1 lakh megawatt, so that industry has a clear cut time margin of 24 months to execute these projects, because normally the time period is 13 months, but many a times some problems come and some targets are not achieved, and then some re-tendering has to be done, or something, some exigencies are there. So by March 2020, all 1 lakh gigawatt will be bidded out, and that and we have also published in that how we are going to bid out in the next year and the year thereafter. So it should give a confidence and adequate time for the industry to plan for it, number one. Now, there comes the question of some new things which are now being planned. This was only related to how to achieve a 1 lakh gigawatt, but there are a lot of other things which are happening, may be of interest to all of you. The rooftop sector, solar sector, has not picked up. One of the reason is that the DISCOMs are not showing interest, because you know there is a tariff is in a slab manner, that is in domestic area the initial few hundred units are charged at a very low rate, 2 rupees, 2.5, 3 rupees, and gradually it increases, and the industrial or commercial sector, they are charged around 7, 8, 10 rupees. Now, most of the industry and commercial sector want to set up, because By setting up, they get a power of, even if they don't invest any money, if they set up in a RESCO model, where the developer comes and sets up the plant and gives the supply in 4, 4.5, 5 rupees, he still have a saving of, substantial saving in the electricity bill. But the DISCOM loses heavily on this, because whatever subsidy they are giving to the domestic sector, that they recover from the industrial and the commercial sector. And if they lavishly permit the people in the commercial and the industrial sector to put a solar panel, they will further bleed and will be in debt more. So that is one of the reason. Now, in order to address, now what is the solution? This is a fact of the case, that this is happening. And the only up till now, almost more than 1,000, to be very precise, at 1,041, 1,050 megawatt is installed on the rooftop. Whereas we want to take this target to 40,000 by March 2020. How to do it? We had, in order to address this problem, we had put up a concept note on our website and invited the comments from all the stakeholders. And depending upon the comments and the suggestions, now we are coming out with a new policy, where we are going to put the DISCOM on the forefront. Well, instead of routing through SNAs and then going to DISCOM, and they may get the assistance of SNAs, which has already come up, but they will be suitably compensated for the losses they are suffering through Government of India. That is the planning, so that they also, and the what, as per the suggestions received from various stakeholders, we are going to, and the DISCOMs also, there are a lot of suggestions. The incentivization to the DISCOM will be gradual. Gradual means, if somebody adds so much of capacity, he will get some incentive. If he adds higher capacity, he is going to be incentivized at a higher rate. That is the purpose to, because the actual, you know, in a household or for a common person, the electricity has no color. Whether it comes from thermal or hydro or solar or wind or anything, for him electricity is coming. Visibility will come to any person, or actual advantage comes to a person when the it is actually set up on each and every household. Everyone has access to it and he can see to it. And wherever the electricity is produced, then and there it is consumed. The losses, transmission, everything is saved, and the real benefit comes. And the pressure on the land, which is now being felt because of the big solar parks coming, ultimately the land is being used for that. So, and the rooftop is already available. It is of hardly any use as of now. So that rooftop sector has to come up. And this is how very shortly Government of India is coming out with a policy which is going to benefit the rooftop owners, to the industry, to the DISCOMs. We are trying to bring out a policy in such a manner that this should take off. And so the people have to take into account that this is in the offing. A number of other schemes which we may likely to come, as you know, in the budget, the government has announced that for the farmers, we are going to have a policy where the farmers will be permitted to set up the solar plants on their farms or in the surplus land or in the uncultivated land. He has a land, but he can't use it. He can set up a plant and then he can generate the electricity and also sell it to the DISCOM. Besides using it for the agriculture pumps, I think how many of you know about it, that out of the total electricity consumption in the country, whatever we consume in industry, domestic, everywhere, or street light, anything, whatever we use, 18% to 19% is used only by the agriculture pumps. So agriculture pumps, solarization of those agriculture pumps, both which are grid connected and which are not grid connected, that is which are the diesel pumps, off-grid pumps, and the solar pumps do not utilize the electricity all the around the year. It is only during the paddy season when watering is required. Rest of the time sun is available, but a pump is not required to be run. That time he can sell his energy to the DISCOM. And DISCOM, you see the benefit to the DISCOM. In a large number of states, either the electricity to the farmers has been made free or at a highly subsidized rate, and DISCOM is bleeding heavily. And if it at the tail end, you give a solar energy for which he doesn't have to pay anything. And if you know the existing scheme, there is already a one scheme already running where Government of India, MNRE gives a 30% subsidy on the pump, solar pump, and 30% subsidy is given by the states, and out of the balance 40%, most of the cases they are in a position to get the 30% loan from the banks or the financial institutions, and the farmer has to spend almost 10% of the cost of the pump. This scheme is already there, and almost in the last 2 years, 1.5 lakh pumps have already been installed and commissioned. So when it is set up at the tail end, now you see that DISCOMs has two benefits. Number one, they don't have to give the subsidized power or the free power. And number two, from wherever the power was coming, the transmission losses are reduced. The major advantage, another advantage because of this is that when you have a free power, then you keep on running. The consumption of power is more and the wastage of water is more. Once a farmer knows that I can sell the surplus power to the DISCOM, he will run it only for the purpose for which it is needed, and the balance he will supply, he will not run the pump unnecessarily. You will not only save the electricity, you will also save the water level in everywhere. Yeah, yeah. So this is policy which are coming up. But in addition to solarization of pump, as I just now said, in their surplus land also, they will be permitted to set up the solar plants. If farmer cannot set up, how farmer will set up a solar plant? Just, it is difficult. Na? So even we are thinking that a developer can, some farmers or a panchayat or a society or a cooperative of the farmer, they can decide and select a developer who can set up a plant from them. They can also lease. They can either sell the power to the DISCOM or they can lease out their land to the developer, and who in turn can tie up with the DISCOM, who already knows it. So these type of things, again, whatever solarization come, it is going to come, the solar industry have to supply the panels and all other balance of material. And this is another field area which is in the offing, and where all of you have a chance to think about it and plan for it and make use of the opportunity which is coming in the offing. And once you were, I think in this conference, you are talking about the technology also, that I must share some of the things about technology, which is where we are encouraging. If there are some people from the R&D organization or the institutes, let me share with them. We have plans and lot of funds also available, and we are supporting a large number of R&D projects of all the IITs, NITs and other research organizations. Recently, we have given a project to BHEL. You know, what happens is most of the panels are now, from starting 2 years back, from 14-15% efficiency have now touched the level of 19-20%. Now in the solar energy, if you know, there is only a small band of the energy which is a visible light. There are infrared and the ultraviolet rays which do not get absorbed, and in the visible light also the lower frequency the lights are do not get absorbed, they pass through. So the PERC technology has come world over, which is increasing the efficiency by 2.5%, that is from 20 it may go to 22.5 or so. It is substantial. That means you need a 10% less panels, you need a 10% less land, and the cost may come down per watt. Or so this technology as of now is not available in India, and BHEL We have awarded a contract to BHL, and BHL is going to set up this facility in Gurgaon in their R&D center. Already they are in an advanced stage, and by before the end of this year, that technology will be available. And possibly they are also going to set up, along with the technology, a pilot project to manufacture some panels, and thereafter this technology should be available for the industry to take it, and all the manufacturers can thereafter plan how to supplement their existing manufacturing facilities to produce the latest technology solar panels. Because nowadays, with the type of competition which is prevailing in the solar industry, which has already brought down the solar electricity prices as low as 2.44 in Rajasthan in the last bid. So any amount of improvement in efficiency or any amount of such development will definitely give a cutting edge to the people who go for it. So this is this thing. And if there are some people here, I don't know about the thermal part, so let me tell you, our National Institute of Solar Energy at Gurgaon, NICE, they are already come up with a very good systems. And now we are going to launch a pilot project in the field, at least 10 number each. They have developed a 24/7 cold storage by the solar. Normally solar energy is available with you in the daytime, and if there is a surplus power, if you are grid connected, you can send it to the grid. Otherwise you store it in the battery. This is the system. But storage, getting us electric energy through the solar PV panel and storage in the battery is a very convenient method, but not a very efficient method. The most efficient method, though it is not convenient, is you take it in the thermal form, heating it, and then store it in a thermal form, means by the phase change. What they have done is, the energy which is coming, solar energy, that is used to run a refrigeration cold storage plant to keep it at 4 degrees centigrade, what is the temperature required, and the excess energy is stored in the form of making a ice in the storage. That is a thermal storage, and that is, that ice is being used, that liquid phase change, that is used 24 hours, that in the night or when sun is not there, that temperature of 4 degrees maintained 24/7. That we call it as a 24/7 cold storage with the solar cold storage. Similarly, for kitchen, they have come out with a 24/7 kitchen system they have developed. What they do is, there you are storing the solar energy in the form of a ice, there you are storing in the form of a molten salt or vaporizing it at 500 or 550 degrees centigrade, and when sun is not there, you utilize that heat round the clock in the kitchen. So these things they have physically demonstrated, and now we are going to launch in the field. At least 10 sets in the field in different areas we will put up. And then thereafter we are going to invite the industry, please take it and wherever you want, spearhead it. So these things in the field of technology are coming. I also read your agenda, 1500 kilowatt inverter you are talking. I think as of now, the facility of 1500 kilowatt is not there in India. So if people are coming in this world, they are most welcome to contact our NICE nation. They are already planning to have been directed to set up the facility up to 2 megawatt inverter testing facilities, because this has become a norm. In the 250 or 500 or 1000 megawatt plants, now people are utilizing a bigger inverters and as high as up to 2 megawatt. So if we don't have a testing facility, possibly this may become a hindrances. Then you know that BIS standards have already been notified, and gadget notification is already there. In the year 2018-19, all of you, the whatever material is there, they have to be tested as per BIS standards, not that IEC standards which get certified from across the from overseas countries. They'll have to be tested as per BIS standard in India, and the labs are getting geared up. One gentleman who is from testing laboratory, he also met me. So you can see the BIS standards, and just see that how to set up the facilities so that you, as of now, there are only three laboratories. One is a high physics lab at Pune, and one is a UV lab, and third is a NICE, who are now gearing up. But the requirement will be substantial when you made it mandatory that all the equipment should be tested as per BIS standard. So labs, the representative from labs must gear up, and those who are planning to set up the facilities, they can come up very fast, because from 1st April onward, there will be enough load of testing with the testing laboratories in this direction. The one issue which the organizer asked me to address was about the related to the anti-dumping and safeguard duty and the GST and these issue. I tell you, the as far as your anti-dumping and safeguard is concerned, it is a, there are two groups in the industry. One are the manufacturers, one are the developers, and there are, their interests are clashing in this. Definitely, everyone will agree that industry in India, in-house manufacturing has to be encouraged. They have invested so much, and it gives employment, and it increases the overall growth of the country. So, but it cannot be that at the cost of jeopardizing the program of solarization of the entire country. So their representations are already with the DG safeguard, and they will take a, it is a quasi-judicial organization which will take a view on this. But as far as anti-dumping is concerned, the association who has filed it, they have already withdrawn it. So since they have withdrawn it now, as of now, we don't know. Somebody told me they are going for a fresh petition, but as of now, nothing is there. So anti-dumping at present is not there. Safeguard, they are going to take a view. There also, there are a conflict between the domestic industry. Some of the industries are in the SEZ zone and some are not in SEZ zone, and it is not clear whether SEZ zone will get exemption from the safeguard duty or not. Unless, if they are not exempted, then within India, within domestic industry, one set will be has to pay the duty, and then the purpose of safeguard duty is not served. If half of the industry is subjected to that duty, half is not. If the entire industry is not subjected, then it will encourage the in-house manufacturing. So the view is likely to be taken shortly. We have, from our ministry side, we have already requested and had a series of meetings with the finance ministry and the MK to expedite it, because there is an uncertainty in the mind of the industry that how do we bid, whether we take into consideration or not. One of the suggestions in the last meeting was from the solar manufacturers. Incidentally, we are holding at MNRE every year, first of every month. First means 1st of April or 1st of June or 1st of May. We hold a meeting with all the manufacturers and developers in MNRE. It is a date and time at 3 o'clock. We don't advise anybody. This is already a standing, and second, we have a for wind energy manufacturers. So this is a very good system. I must appreciate everyone knows. So if some people don't know, if they want to participate, they want to have a views that they express, they can always come there and join. And we have a very good interaction, and all the problems, all the views, everything is discussed, and wherever we can give a solution, we do it. Because while sitting in office, we may not know what is the pulse of the field and what problems you are experiencing. It is only through this association and interaction we come to know about it. So those of you, the developers or manufacturers, anytime you have any problem, you have an opportunity to visit MNRE on the 1st of every month. If first working day, means suppose first is a Sunday, that means on 2nd it will be there. First working day of every month, it is there. So this briefly, I could tell you about what is happening and what we are planning. For small, last time somebody said, what about these are all for the big manufacturers. Some for small manufacturer also, I may tell you, for small industries, some good policies are there. One is a student lamp. You know, even if now there is a Ministry of Power has come out with a Saubhagya scheme. That means they will take the electricity to each and every village, each and every house by March 2019. But even if you take electricity to each and every village, every house, there are so much of poverty that people will not be in a position to pay. They don't have anything to eat. They will not be in a position to pay the electricity bill and all that. But still, you have taken the electricity, and bachchon ko agar padhna hai, to what do we do? There is a student's lamp with the IIT Bombay we have developed. It is just costing, last year it was 600 rupees, now it has come down to 450 rupees. One lamp with a battery and a solar panel, sufficient for a student to read for 4-5 hours in the night, and on the table he can keep. Now out of 600, 500 rupees MNR is paying, and student has to pay only 100 rupees. Now with the 450 rupees prices come down, then we will see that the student contribution is further reduced, and we are going to give it in all the backward areas, all the wherever people are there, and next 1 year we are going to spread it so that the students have it. And similarly, once you go for a electrification in all the villages and houses, but you will not electrify each and every street or the corners. There will be a large number of dark corners, the streets, and so there is a street lights, solar street lights will anyway coming in a big way. So there the requirement is of the small solar panels and balance of system, and the small manufacturers, MSME people, they who are willing to enter into this area and are unable to quote in the big tenders and find a place over there, they have these areas. Another thing is a chula, solar chula, that 24/7 I said, that is coming up. We are going to launch it very soon. We are, say, in the remote areas, in the islands. How many of you know, I came to know recently only, in the Andaman Nicobar Island and the Lakshadweep Islands, how do they get electricity? They only buy diesel. So much amount of diesel is being burnt over there, and we have been given a directive to green those, make a green energy, total solarization or wind energy, we are going to do it. We are planning now to take on every house that chula, solar chula we provide there to everyone, so that to that extent it is good, electricity will be there. We are going to set up a 50 megawatt in Andamak and 10 megawatt in Lakshadweep solar energy plants. Besides that, this will also be there, where you will have a 24 hours kitchen to be run on the solar. So these initiatives are coming, which will opening up a lot of opportunity to the industry and to the test labs and to the R&D centers. We have, regarding R&D, let me tell you, we have a lot of funds. We approve the projects which are good projects, and we also fund them. So the people who want to get some, who have a good ideas and good projects, and they want to get it funded or want to show it to us or want to proliferate it, they are most welcome. If they, we can always get them associated with our institute NICE, and they can do it. NICE has recently, apart from various courses which we are doing, they have done a very good thing now. They have launched first course of 6 months, that is a professional solar entrepreneurs, where they will cover everything. So the entrepreneurs availability will be there, because as of now, what is happening, you set up so many plants and very pace, now who will maintain it? Tomorrow the person should have confidence, tomorrow problem comes, who will maintain it? How the O&M will be carried out? Who will guide them? How entrepreneurs are required for handling this complete industry? So first batch will come out somewhere in April. We have started it, and industry people will get qualified entrepreneurs in this field. And if you want your people, your employees or some people also to be trained over there, you have an opportunity. You can visit the NICE website and get details about it. And Mr. Manu Srivastava, who is my come from MP, let me tell you, for DISCOM official, we have started a very good program of training where they can be trained and they can proliferate it. And now we are going to request all the state governments that they should, we are ready to make more number of courses for DISCOM, so that once a new scheme of rooftop comes, then the role of DISCOM will increase many fold. That time it will come very handy, and so we have taken an advance action. So whatever I have told you, now I must for a minute I brief about Mr. Manu also, that he is very energetic. I have interacted him for the last 1 month only. Everyone appreciates, if you, the people in my last conference when we met, he says, if you talk about dynamism, it is Mr. Manu. That is the reputation he has got. It is very nice that today he is here in this, and he is taking lot of initiative in taking this solar mission forward in his state, Madhya Pradesh. And this is good for the country as a whole that solarization should come up, because our dependence on oil and will reduce, our pollution will reduce, our health will improve, and we'll become self-dependent on energy to some extent, whatever we do it. This is in the overall interest of the country and all of us also. So now thank you. I have tried to cover most of the things which was expected from me, and I'll be here for 10 minutes more because the parliament session is going on. I'd come especially for this. If anyone has any questions, I've already told them they can take in next 10-15 minutes. Thereafter, I'll be taking leave. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for a very, very kind of comprehensive review of, you know, what all your ministry has been doing. I think it's fair to say that in the last, nearly 3.5 years, the work done by the MNRE is truly transformational. I think to displace, you know, the bigger power ministry as the largest source of incremental power capacity addition in the country. And I think, sir, with the electric vehicle kind of programs, etc., the day is not far where you will even surpass the oil ministry as the key to India's energy future. I think the MNRE will be responsible for meeting India's overall energy requirement, in the near future.